DC motors. So the topic that we'll tackle today is about motor principle, comparison of generator and motor action, significance of the back EMF, voltage equation of a motor, condition for maximum power, torque, armature torque of a motor, shaft torque, and speed of a DC motor. Motor principle. Motor principle state that when a current carrying conductor is located in external magnetic field perpendicular to the conductor experiences a force that is both perpendicular to both itself and the external magnetic field. Constructionally, there is no basic difference between a DC generator and a DC motor. The same DC machine can be used interchangeably as a generator or as a motor. DC motors are also like generators, shunt wound, or compound wound. To further understand the working principle of a DC motor, a video presentation will be played next.
Working principle of DC motor. Working principle of DC motor is very simple. We can see that when the current conductor is placed in magnetic field, it experiences some force in particularly direction. The very basic construction of a DC motor contains a current carrying armature, which is connected to the supply and through commutator segments and brushes. The armature is placed between north and south pole of a permanent or an electromagnet, an elementary model. One single turn of conductor is placed between two opposite poles. If we start to supply DC via commutator system, current will start to flow. As we see, positive terminal of a battery is connected to left conductor of a turn, and negative terminal is connected to right conductor of a turn. As we see in model, north pole of the magnet is placed near left side, and south pole is placed near right side of the turn. Current in left side flows inward, and current in right side flows outward. As we see, conductor is carrying current and they placed in magnetic field. Both of them experienced mechanical force acted on them. Direction of mechanical force can be easily determined by applying Fleming's left hand rule. To do this, spread out your left thumb, forefinger, and second finger so they are all at 90 degrees to one another. With that, if the forefinger is aligned along direction of magnetic field, from north pole to the south pole, and second finger is aligned along direction of the current in left side conductor, then thumb indicates direction of mechanical force. Similarly, if the forefinger is aligned along direction of magnetic field, from north pole to the south pole, and second finger is aligned along direction of the current in right side conductor, then thumb indicates direction of mechanical force. Due to this upward and downward forces on the turn, one torque is produced when turn rotates on clockwise direction as shown. After rotation of the turn, turn comes to vertical position in respect of the magnetic field. At this position there is no current in conductor because turn, conductor and brushes rest between two commutators. Hence, there is no force acting on conductor by due to moment of inertia, turn continue to rotate and comes horizontal again. Position of conductor has been changed here. That means conductor which was previously in left position comes to right position, and which was previously in right position comes to left position. At that position, we can determine mechanical force with applying Fleming's left hand rule. Let's do that. To do this, spread out your left thumb, forefinger, and second finger so they are all at 90 degrees to one to another. So if forefinger is a line in direction of magnetic field, that is, from North Pole to South Pole, and second finger is aligned in direction of a current in the left side conductor, then thumb indicates direction of mechanical force. This is clearly upward here. So if forefinger is a line in direction of magnetic field, that is, from North Pole to South Pole, and second finger is aligned in direction of a current in the right side conductor, then thumb indicates direction of mechanical force. This is clearly downward here. Do this upward and downward forces, turn, tends to rotate in clockwise direction. From that explanation we can come to conclusion that here in this model we can see that whichever conductor comes near South Pole, experience upward mechanical force, and near North Pole, downward mechanical force. And do this continuously forces, mechanical turn rotate, even if battery is not connected. Particularly DC motor, rotates, at the same principle like this elementary model. Instead of single turn in DC motor we have mountain turns on major coil. And instead of two poles there is number of poles installed.
Comparison of generator and motor action. For a generator, the input energy is mechanical energy and the useful output energy is electrical energy. In power stations, it is usually the magnet which is attached to the axle and rotated, with a coil surrounding the magnet. However, the end result is the same. For a motor, the input energy is electrical energy and the useful output energy is mechanical energy. The generator is used to produce an electric current from rotational motion. On large-scale power stations, a turbine is used to provide this rotation. In a generator, the rotation causes the coil to rotate inside the magnetic field. This induces an alternating current in the coil. The following are the difference between motor and generator. The first one is that motor converts electrical energy into mechanical energy, while generator converts mechanical energy to electrical energy. The second is that motor uses electricity, while generator generates electricity. Third is, the shaft of the motor is driven by the magnetic force developed between the armature and the field, while the shaft in the generator is attached to the rotor and is driven by mechanical force. Fourth is, in a motor, the current is to be supplied to the armature winding. However, in the generator, current is produced in the armature windings. Last, motor follows Fleming's left-hand rule, while generator follows Fleming's right-hand rule. To further elaborate the significance of back EMF, we should know first what is back EMF. So back EMF is an electromagnetic force appearing in an inductive circuit in such a direction as to oppose any change of current in the circuit. So it has two equations. The first one is V minus I sub A times R sub A. The second one is flux times Z times N times P over A. So I sub A means the armature current, which is, we get it from the equation V minus V sub B over RA. R sub A means armature resistance. Z means the number of conductor. N is the speed in terms of RPS. P means the number of poles. Significance of back EMF. Back EMF is very significant in the working of a DC motor. The presence of back EMF makes this DC motor a self-regulating machine. It makes the motor to draw as much armature current as it just sufficient to develop the torque required by the load. Significance of back EMF is as follows. When the motor is running on no load, Small torque is required to overcome the friction and windage loses. Therefore, the armature current is small and the back EMF is nearly equal to the applied voltage. If the motor is suddenly loaded, the first effect is to cause the armature to slow down. Therefore, the speed at which the armature conductors move through the field is reduced and hence the back EMF falls. The decreased back EMF allows a larger current to flow through the armature, and larger current means increased driving torque. Thus, the driving torque increases as the motor slows down. The motor will stop slowing down when the armature current is just sufficient to produce the increased torque required by the load. If the load on the motor is decreased, the driving torque is momentarily in excess of the requirement, so that armature is accelerated. As the armature speed increases, the back EMF also increases and causes the armature current to decrease. The motor will stop accelerating when the armature current is just sufficient to produce the reduced torque required by the load. Therefore, the back EMF in a DC motor regulates the flow of armature current. It automatically changes the armature current to meet the load requirement. Voltage equation of a motor. Input voltage provided to the motor armature can perform the following two tasks. The first is obtain control and back EMF of the motor. The second is provide supply to the ohmic I/A/R/A drop. So the voltage equation of the motor is equal to back EMF plus armature current times armature resistance. By multiplying both sides, the voltage equation of a motor by IA, we get the power equation of a DC motor, which is EB times IA plus IA squared times RA. EBIA means the mechanical power developed in armature, and IA squared RA means the power loss in armature. Some of the input power is weighted as copper loss in winding, and rest of the power is converted into mechanical power. So our mechanical power is equal to V times I/A minus I/A squared times RA. To get the motor efficiency, we just have to divide output with input, or E/B over V. Conditions for maximum power. Gross mechanical power developed by motor is equal to V times IA minus IA squared times RA. Differentiating by both sides by IA, we get V minus 2IA times RA. If the differential is equal to zero, motor will deliver maximum power. So, condition for maximum power will only be achieved if the differential is equal to zero. Also, V minus 2 times IA times RA equals to zero, we get three equations that will help us in solving the problem. So, the first one is IA times RA is equal to V over 2. The second is V is equal to EB plus IA times RA. The third is IA times RA equals V minus EB. Thus, the motor will develop maximum power when the back EMF is equal to half of the applied armature voltage. However, this condition cannot be realized if the back EMF is half of the applied armature voltage. The motor will draw more current than its rated current, and efficiency of the motor will be below 50%. Example, a 220-volt DC machine has an armature resistance of 0.5 ohms. If the full load armature is 20 ampere, find the induced EMF when the machine acts as generator as motor. For the generator, we use the equation V plus I/A times R/A. So it is equal to 220 plus 20 times 0.5. So the induced EMF for generator is 230 volts. For motor, we use the equation V minus I/A times R/A. Therefore, 220 minus 20 times 0.5. So the induced EMF for motor is equal to 210 volts. Another example, a 440 volt shunt motor has an armature resistance of 0.8 ohms and a field resistance of 200 ohms. Determine the back EMF when given an output of 7.46 kilowatts at 85% efficiency. So this problem wants us to find the back EMF. So the equation for back EMF is equal to V minus I sub A times R sub A. Since voltage and armature resistance is already given in the problem, we have to find out first the I sub A. So I sub A can only be get if we find motor current and the shunt current. Therefore, the first thing that we have to do is find the motor input current, which is 7460 watts over the efficiency, which is 0.85, times the voltage 440, which is 19.95. The second is we have to find the shunt current, which is voltage, which is 440, divided by the field resistance, which is 200 ohms. And then we get 2.2 ampere. Subtracting 2 from 19.95, we get 17.75, which is our armature current. Therefore, by substituting the given values to the equation V minus I sub A times RA, we get the back EMF, which is 425.8 volts. Another example, a 25 kilowatt 250 volt DC shunt generator has armature and field resistance of 0.06 ohms and 100 ohms respectively. Determine the total armature power developed when working as a generator delivering a 25 kilowatt output and as a motor taking 25 kilowatt input. So the given are power, which is 25,000 watts, voltage, which is 250 volts, armature resistance, which is 0.06 ohms, and field resistance, which is 100 ohms. Armature current is also given, which is 102.5 ampere, and it is based on the figure that is given. To find the power, we have to find first the generated EMF, which is V plus I sub A times R sub A. It is equal to 250 volts plus 102.5 ampere times 0.06, and the equals is 256.15 volts, which is our generated EMF. To get the power, we just have to multiply the generated EMF to the armature current, and we get the power, which is 26.255 kilowatts. To get the armature power of the motor, we find first its generated EMF by using the equation V minus I sub A times R sub A, where the armature current is equal to 97.5 ampere. Therefore, our generated EMF is equal to 244.15 volts. To get the armature power, we have to multiply the generated EMF to its armature current, and the power is 23.805 kilowatt. Another example, a 4-pole 32-conductor lap wound DC shunt generator with terminal voltage of 200 volts delivering 12 ampere to the load has armature resistance of 2 and field circuit resistance of 200 ohms. It is driven at 1000 RPM. Calculate the flux per pole in the machine. If the machine has to be run as a motor with the same terminal voltage and drawing 5 ampere from the mains, maintaining the same magnetic field, find the speed of the machine. So the given are, V is equals to 200 volts, I is equals to 12 ampere, armature resistance equals to 2, field resistance equals to 200 ohms, Z is equals to 32. Since N is given in RPM, we just have to divide it by 60 for it to be in RPS. So, The induced EMF is equivalent to V plus I sub A times R sub A. Substituting the given values, we get a 226 volts induced EMF. Since that induced EMF is also our equivalent back EMF, we have to use the equation flux times Z times N times P over A to get the flux per pole. And since P is equals to A, we just have to divide back EMF by Z over N. And we have 225 times 60 over 1000 times 32. And we have a flux per pole, which is 0.42375 Weber. To find the speed of the motor, we also have to find its back EMF. And since in the figure, the armature current is already given, which is 4 ampere. Therefore, back EMF, which is equal to V minus I sub A times R sub A, is equal to 200 minus 4 times 2, and we have a back EMF of 192 volts. Since the figure shows that P is equals to A, we just have to rearrange back EMF is equivalent to flux times Z times N, and since N stands for the speed, we just have to rearrange it. Therefore, we have an equation of 192 over flux, which is 0.42375 multiplied to Z, which is 32, and since N is in terms of RPM, we just have to multiply it by 60. So the speed is equivalent to 850 RPM. Torque. Torque is meant the turning or twisting of a force about an axis. It is measured by the product of the force and the radius at which this force acts. Therefore, the torque equation is equal to force times radius. Its value is in terms of Newton meter. Work done by this force in one revolution is equals to F times 2 pi R. Power developed is equals to F times 2 pi R times N. By simplifying it, we get a power developed, which is torque times angular velocity, in which angular velocity is equivalent to 2 pi N, and it is in term of radius per second. If N is in RPM, we just have to divide 2 pi N by 60. Armature torque of a motor, which is denoted by a symbol T sub A. Therefore, the power developed is equivalent to T sub A times angular velocity. Its angular velocity is equivalent to 2 pi times N over 60, whereas T sub A is the torque developed by the armature of a motor running at N is in RPM. Armature converts electrical power to mechanical power. Therefore, mechanical power is equivalent to electrical power. That means T sub A times 2 pi N over 60 is equivalent to back EMF times armature current. Back EMF is equivalent to flux times Z times N times P over A. And since N should be in terms of RPM, we have to divide it by 60. Substituting it to the previous equation and rearranging it to a simpler form, we can get the armature torque of a motor, which is equivalent to P times Z over 2 pi A times flux times armature current. In DC series motor, the armature current also flows through the field circuit. This is because the field and armature are in series in DC series motor. Again, the field flux is directly proportional to the current flowing through the field. That means, flux is directly proportional to armature current. Now, we can write from the expression of armature torque of DC motor, which is that torque is directly proportional to the squared of armature current. In DC shunt motor, the field flux is approximately constant. So we can say the armature torque is only proportional to the armature current. We do not get the entire armature torque on the shaft as output mechanical torque of the DC motor. because a small percentage of armature torque has to supply the iron loss, frictional and windage losses of the machine. After these losses, whatever torque available at the shaft of the machine does the useful work as output. We call this remaining torque as shaft torque of the DC motor because this torque is only available at the shaft. Therefore, motor output is equivalent to shaft torque times 2 pi n. Rearranging the previous equation, we get shaft torque is equivalent to output in watts over 2 pi n divided by 60. It is divided by 60 because n is sometimes given in RPS. And in this equation, n should be in RPM. So finalizing it, we get 60 times output in watts over 2 pi n. Example, a DC motor takes an armature current of 110 ampere at 480 volts. The armature circuit resistance is 0.2 ohms. The machine has 6 poles and the armature lap connected with 864 conductors. The flux per pole is 0.05 Weber. First, calculate the speed. Second, the gross torque developed by the armature. So the first thing that we have to do is find the back EMF. So 480 minus 110 times 0.2, we get 458 volts. Since P is equals to A and it is equals to 6, we can cancel out P over A in the other equation of back EMF, which is flux times Z times N times P over A. Therefore, rearranging it to get the speed, we get 458 over 0.05, which is the flux, times the conductor, 864, and it is multiplied by 60 because it should be in terms of RPM. Therefore, our speed is equivalent to 636 RPM. To get the gross torque, we have to use its equation, which is P times Z over 2 pi A times flux times armature current. Since P is equivalent to A, it will be canceled out because it is equivalent to 1. Therefore, our armature torque is equivalent to 864 times 0.05 times 110 over 2 pi, which is 756.3 newton meter. Another example, a 250 volt 4 pole wave 1 DC series motor has 782 conductors on its armature. It has armature and series field resistance of 0.75 ohms. The motor takes a current of 40 ampere. Estimate its speed and gross torque developed if it has a flux per pole of 25 milliweber. The first thing that we have to get is the back EMF given by the equation V minus I sub A times R sub A. Substituting the given values, we get an back EMF of 220 volts. Since back EMF is equivalent to flux times Z times N times P over A, in which in finding the speed, P is equivalent to A. Therefore, rearranging it to find the speed, we get 220 or back EMF over flux times Z. Therefore, it becomes 220 over 25 times 10 raised to negative 3 times 864, and since it should be in RPM, it is multiplied by 60 and it becomes 611 RPM. To get the gross torque, we have to use the armature torque equation, in which the pole is equivalent to 4 and A is equivalent to 2. Therefore, substituting the value in the given equation, we get armature torque is equivalent to 249 newton meter. Another example, a DC shunt machine develops an AC EMF of 250 volts at 1500 RPM. Finds its torque and mechanical power developed for an armature current of 50 amperes. State the simplifying assumptions. Assumption: a DC machine developed the same EMF in its armature conductor whether running as a generator or as a motor. When the machine is running as a motor, it is an armature EMF known as back EMF. So in order to find the mechanical power, we just have to multiply back EMF with armature current. And since back EMF is equivalent to armature current, we have to use the 250 volts. And it should be multiplied to its armature current, which is 50. Therefore, mechanical power is 12,500 watts. To find its torque, we have to use the equation T sub A times 2 pi N over 60 is equivalent to E sub B times I sub A. Rearranging it to find its torque, we get an equation of E sub B times I sub A times 60 over 2 pi N. Therefore, our torque is 79.6 Newton meter. Another example, determine developed torque and shaft torque of 220 volt 4-pole series motor with 800 conductors wave connected supplying a load of 8.2 kilowatts by taking 45 ampere from the mains. The flux per pole is 25 milliweber and its arm resistance is 0.6 ohms. To find the developed torque, we just have to use the equation P times Z over 2 pi A times flux times armature current. Substituting what is given, we get 186.2 Newton meter. To find the shaft torque, we have to find first its back EMF so that we can get the N. So back EMF is equivalent to 220 minus 45 times 0.6, which is equals to 193 volts. This 193 volt equated to flux times Z times N times P over A. Rearranging it and finding the value of the speed, we get an N which is 4.825 RPS. So now we can find the shaft torque. Shaft torque equation is equivalent to output times 60 over 2 pi N. It is times 60 in there because the N is in terms of RPS and it should be in RPM. Therefore, shaft torque is equivalent of 270 Newton meter. Last example, a 500 volt, 37.3 kilowatt, 1000 RPM DC shunt motor has on full load an efficiency of 90%. The armature circuit resistance is 0.24 ohms and there is total voltage drop of 2 volts at the brushes. The field current is 1.8 ampere. Determine first full load line current, second full load shaft torque in Newton meter, and third total resistance in motor starter to limit the starting current to 1.5 times the full load current. The first thing that we have to do is find the motor input, and it is equal to the power of the motor over its efficiency, which is 37,300 watts over 0.9. We have motor input of 41,444 watts. And in order to find the full load line current, we just have to divide motor input by its voltage, which is 500 volts. Therefore, full load line current is equals to 82.9 ampere. To find the full load shaft torque, we just have to use the shaft torque equation, which is output times 60 times 2 pi N. The output in there is the power of the motor, which is 37,300 watts, and it is multiplied by 60 divided by 2 times pi times 100, and we get a shaft torque, which is 356 Newton meter. To find the total resistance in the motor starter, the first thing to do is to find the starting line current, by multiplying 1.5 to the full load line current, which is 82.9 from previous solution. The result is then 124.3 ampere. The next thing to do is to solve for the armature current, starting by subtracting field current 1.8 ampere from 124.3 ampere. Therefore, we have a result of 122.5 ampere. If R is the starter resistance, then voltage of the armature plus voltage of the brushes is equivalent to voltage of the motor. It will then become current of the armature times resistance of the armature plus voltage of the brushes is equivalent to voltage of the motor. Substituting what is already given and then rearranging it, we get the total resistance in the motor starter, which is 3.825 ohms. Speed of a DC motor. For the equation for the speed of a DC motor is equivalent to back EMF divided by flux multiplied to 60 times A over Z times P. And it is multiplied to 60 because it is in terms of RPM. Or N is equals to K times back EMF over flux. Speed is directly proportional to EMF and inversely to the flux. We let N sub 1 be the speed in the first case. I sub A1 is the armature current in the first case. Flux 1 is the flux or pole in the first case. And the other is the current corresponding quantities in the second case. Speed of a DC series motor. So we have two equations. The first one is N sub 2 over N sub 1 is equal to E sub B2 over E sub B1 multiplied to flux 1 over flux 2. In which in here, the flux is directly proportional to the armature current. The second equation is N sub 2 over N sub 1 is equivalent to E sub B2 over E sub B1 multiplied to I sub A1 over I sub A2. Speed of a DC shunt motor. So it has two equations. First one is N sub 2 over N sub 1 is equivalent to E sub B2 over E sub B1 multiplied to flux sub 1 over flux sub 2. If flux 1 and the flux 2 is equal, we have then the equation N sub 2 over N sub 1 equals to E sub B2 over E sub B1